Greetings, and welcome to another Lazy Game Reviews video of something. Not necessarily a review of a game, but something that games could be played on if you wanted to. This awesome piece of vintage hardware is the Zenith Data Systems Z-171 Transportable Lunchbox PC. And it was originally manufactured in April 1985 by Zenith Data Systems. Well, actually, this one was made by a company called Vadim. This was an OEM design that was given out to several different companies. Zenith just happened to be one of them. They released it under the Z-170 and Z-171 line of their own PC compatibles. But there were other computer companies that made these things more or less based on this design. One of them was Moro, who released it under the Pivot, probably the main competitor to this machine. And then there was Osborne, who released the Encore with this same basic design. Now, both the Pivot and the Encore had lower res displays, among other changes, so this one right here was the one that kind of won out overall with this design. Now, what actually set this thing apart was the fact that it was a PC compatible, that it was, you know, it was compatible with the IBM PC standard. It ran an MS-DOS operating system, or PC-DOS, I guess, if you really wanted to, and had an Intel 8088 processor, you know, the x86 series of CPUs. But what this set this apart was it was one of the very first of the PC compatibles to have an LCD display, which was actually backlit. So you could actually use it in situations that were less than ideal. Of course, still not in the sunlight. You're still kind of screwed in that case. And this was also one of the earliest systems to be battery-powered, or portable IBM-compatible systems, at least. So, yes, it did have a battery, and, you know, unlike other machines that were portable or transportable back then, like the K-Pro and other Osborne machines, like the Osborne 1 and the Executive, this actually had a battery inside. So, if you had a battery, that is, it would go right in here. Otherwise, you could just plug it straight into the wall like you could with any number of other portable computers. There we go. Another thing, yeah, it was that the fact that this thing was pretty friggin' small. It was, I think it's only about 14 pounds, and it's about this big, actually it's about the size of two oversized clothespins. So, if you have one of these handy, that's about how big it is. Now, this thing actually retailed for $26.99, and that's in $1985. So, it wasn't exactly cheap, but it was on par with a lot of other portable systems back then. And the fact that this was smaller and everything else that I've mentioned up to this point made it pretty attractive. In fact, so attractive that it actually ended up beating out the other systems, the Pivot and the Encore and whatever else was based on this design. At least as far as the U.S. government and Navy were concerned, apparently the Z-170 and 171 were very highly bought in quantities, of high quantities, by the government and the Navy, and also insurance salesmen and traveling weirdos that would like to give you trinkets like vacuum cleaners made of glass and wicker, perhaps even large clothespins. I don't know. Whatever they wanted to sell, this thing was there, and it was portable, so they could do it and stuff and look professional. It was also Y2K compatible. Kind of a moot point at this point in time in 2012, but yeah, the clock actually goes up to 2015 without a problem. I don't know what it's going to do after 2015, but who cares? Now, the base configuration of this thing, well, let me just go ahead and show the coolness of this here. Yeah, open up the two little guys up here, and it opens up. Right here, you've got your keyboard. Full travel keys. You got pretty much everything you need for, you know, PC-compatible stuff. And the keys aren't fine. You know, they have rubber domes underneath, so they're not clicky keys, but they're better than these up here. These are actually membrane keys. Very similar to what you found on computers, older computers actually, like the Atari 400, you know, so they work, but they're kind of mushy and gross, but that's okay. What's inside is what really, really counts. This is just, you know, whatever. inside of this, you have... This is not the inside. This is the back. But I feel it serves my illustration purposes because it's something else to look at. Yes, inside of this, you have a 4.77 megahertz 80C88 CPU, which is actually the same CPU that was used in the IBM PC 5140 convertible PC, released in 1986, a year later, so this was actually ahead of the game just a little bit. That right there lent itself to the whole PC compatibility thing. It also ran MS-DOS version 2.11, and this one actually came with version 3.1. Had originally 256K of RAM, expandable up to 640K, which this has as well. On the side here, it has these cool little guys right here. These are two 360K 5.25-inch floppy disk drives. So you just kind of do that right there. Take whatever floppy disk you need. Like here is the operating system. Plop that in there. It'll lock in place. And there you go. And whenever you need it again, it'll launch out the disk and unlock it for you in one swift move, or two or three, or however many times it takes, because it's old and the spring doesn't always work. So two disk drives. Pretty friggin' sweet. Still doesn't have any hard drive or anything, although I guess maybe you could add something to this as an external drive. Maybe an internal one if you were to mod something. I don't know. MFM drive I don't think would fit in here at all. And on here in the back, you actually have some very handy little ports. There's an expansion bus right here, so if you were to get the little cradle or whatever dock to set this thing in and do that, if you wanted to, then you could. I don't think it really does anything else. It's proprietary as far as I know. I don't have the dock or else I'd show you. Right here, we have a RS-232C serial port, a Centronics-compatible parallel port, and then a modem, which is another thing that was a really big selling point with this for traveling people that needed data communication. You could connect this to the internet, or whatever net you had back then to connect to. And it was a 1200 baud Hayes-compatible modem, so pretty sexy stuff for 1985. Another option, which this one thankfully comes with, not all of them did, it was totally an option, was a video card that could be built into this thing, and that provided an output for not only the 10-inch LCD up front, but you have a color RGB, which will hook up to any CGA monitor, and then a composite monochrome output right here, which will allow you to hook it up to a TV or whatever, and of course it'll only be in monochrome. Now on this side... I've already got the battery I've showed you here. Right here we have the adjustment for LCD contrast, power switch, and an AC adapter input. There's also these little guys on each side here. These are to attach a strap to carry it over your shoulder, like a really, really awkward looking lunchbox. So if you wanted to do that, that's fine. Mine doesn't come with a carrying strap, so who cares? I don't need it. I can just carry it under my arm like a complete loser. So, mine also didn't come with a power supply. I just got this thing somewhat recently on eBay for $35. A guy had a whole pallet of them he got from some government something or other. So I'm like, yep, I'll buy one. It didn't come with power supplies though, so I just use a regular power supply here. This is made for laptops. It's got, it's just a universal supply. Any one of those will work as long as it is 15 volts DC. Then, yeah, that's super easy to come by. Okay, let's turn this thing back around. It's like an old creepy door, except it's a computer creepy door. So there's the LCD. It looks lovely. It's 10 inches, which is actually pretty substantial for back then. So, yeah, let's turn this thing on and take a look at it. Well, you can't really see that, but I assure you it's on. Okay, there's the backlight. Might be kind of hard to read because, the LCD isn't in the best of shape, but, it works. The backlight still works sometimes, and yeah. All right, so what it actually boots up here with is something that is Well, it's unique to this system, at least as far as I know. It's definitely not DOS. It is the Zenith clock or time zone thing. I don't really know what they call it. I don't have the manual. But anyway, basically what this shows is the current date and time, and you can also select from different time zones. So, yeah, among other things. It's sort of a scheduling agent. It's part of the productivity software that it actually comes with. And these are all accessible through the function keys. So, yeah, here, let me... So if you see the different things along the bottom here, like if I were to press F1, this would bring up schedule. Yeah, that's essentially how it works. So, you know, you do everything else with like the arrow keys and stuff. But that brings up schedule. Press F10 to exit. Brings right back to the friggin' time zones. Set to 1985 right now because Marty McFly... Let's see. Yeah, we can go to different time zones here. Let me go to my time zone. Because I can. There we go. We can also enter the BIOS setup here. Interestingly, it actually says Morrow/Zenith at the top, so I guess maybe this was shared with Morrow. I don't know. At least in system version 3.3 here. Yeah, we can set the clock. It wouldn't make much of a difference because it won't save it since I don't have an internal battery installed at the moment. If we have the external mono, if we want that to go output to that, we can. The screensaver, which isn't, it's kind of a misnomer. I think that just turns the backlight off. That's turned on. You can make it start up to different things if you don't want it to go to the world map thing. You don't have to. Printer type, modem type, serial port information, internal modem information. Yeah, pretty typical stuff, so... If you want to change all that, that's where you do it. Otherwise, we'll just go back to here. Another function that's inside here, when you press the little telephone button, it'll bring up the calling thing. So if you want to go onto a terminal thing, a terminal program, you can do that. Or if you want to call somebody from your computer, you can do that. There's a port to hook in not only the modem or, you know, modem to the wall, but also a phone into the computer. So acts as kind of a pass-through. And then there's also, let's just go back here. There's also a calculator that you can bring up at any point. So if you want it on that side of the screen or the other side of the screen or whatever, you can do that. And then, of course, the final button here is the MS-DOS button. So do that. Bark. It'll boot straight up from the creepy-sounding floppy drive. And it'll start booting MS-DOS 3.3 or whatever version you have in the floppy drive A. Yay, date and time. Okay, that's everything that's on the current disk. Let's do check disk here. We can look at some memory, which is cool. Because I like memory, baby. We have 630, 784 bytes total memory. So yeah, 640K installed at the moment, 580-ish free. Pretty friggin' awesome. At least, you know, if you want to go for the whole philosophy of, nobody needs more than that. All right, let's put in another floppy disk here. Got a disk of games. Let's see, what is this? There we go. This will be a good one. This one I made that I usually use on my IBM PC, but this will work just fine. Mark. Love that sound. It probably needs some lube and stuff. I've only briefly cleaned it. Hey, whatever. Let's see. What do we have here? Well, let's go ahead and do it. I don't have a joystick plugged in, but I can try it with a keyboard. This is Paratrooper, which you should be able to see sort of some of the CGA capabilities. Alright, so you kind of have to make some sacrifices with this kind of monochrome display like this. CGA has four colors. This really only shows like two with a couple of brightness variations. So if I want, you know, the paratrooper part to be bold, I got to make some sacrifices for other things. It'll be more noticeable in other games, but I'm not even sure. Yeah, see, you can't see anything. There we go. Now I can kind of see things, but... Yeah. It's almost impossible to see what I'm actually where I'm shooting. At least with any kind of accuracy. Oh, man. Wow, I actually hit something. Yeah, okay. No, don't want to do it again. All right, let's get out of here. All right, let's try out Pharaoh's Tomb, the Apogee classic, to those of us who think it's a classic. But it's definitely from Apogee, there's no debate about that. Wow, I can't see anything. There we go. Yeah, this is one of those that the color thing is really noticeable. You have to turn it down, like either you can see the outline of the bricks, or you can't. And, you know, you really have to decide which colors you want to see, which ones are most important. In this case, I need to see myself. Right, so, yeah. Pyramid looks like a nice big solid block, and it actually looks like I have... Ugh. Seems to do that too, actually. Seems to have an issue with holding down a button for too long, so I try not to hold forward too long. I don't know why it does that. But yeah, if you look at the spears down in the bottom right, yeah, I just used one and you can't tell that I have. It looks the same. So you kind of have to kind of mentally keep track of how many spears you have. Because otherwise, if you use it or, you know, adjust the contrast... Oh, crap. To show the spears, then it, you know, you won't be able to see yourself or you won't be able to see the enemies or whatever. So, this thing obviously wasn't meant for gaming, and I know that. It's an old LCD. You know, for what it was and being backlit and stuff, that's pretty friggin' cool. Oh, crap. But yeah, for games, it's pretty awful. Oh, no! Yeah, let's try something else. Since the arrow keys are sort of laid out in a weird position, they're all, like, horizontal. They're next to each other instead of in a, well, a normal configuration. Yeah, neat arrow keys. That was my high score from when I did this and sucked. Anyway. Makes it more than a little bit difficult because, oh, I'm not totally used to the layout of them being all strange like that. I wonder if the numpad would work. That kind of does. It's still not ideal, though, because then you have to press... Ah. Yeah, you have to have the numpad enabled button, and now I'm just sort of pressing 7, 8, 9, U, I, O, J, K, and L. Since it doesn't actually have a numpad. So... Yeah. Oh, great, it's saving that. Yeah, okay. Yeah, Control-Delete doesn't work at all. Pressing that. Whatever. Oh yeah, another interesting thing, you can actually press the other functions to bring up, like, whatever during DOS. Like, see right here, I've pressed the calculator. I can actually do calculations while DOS is going on, which is pretty amazing. Or go back to DOS here, or bring up the phone thing. DOS is still going in the background, so you can go right in between your programs and your other productivity stuff, or I could even go back to the time zone thing and, put something into my schedule while I'm talking to somebody through the phone while Lotus 123 is running in the background, or PC Man, or whatever. So, that's pretty much it. This thing is awesome for what it was back then. Of course, the LCD display really holds it back from being able to do too much. You know, it's... if you're really friggin' desperate, it'll work for games. It's just depends totally on the game and, of course, your tolerance for stuff like this. So, yeah. For productivity, though, and business, whatever, you know, keeping track of your schedule, doing some Lotus 123 or, you know, WordStar or whatever else you happen to have. I mean, it's got an 80-column display, so that's awesome. Yeah, I can totally see why the government or the Navy and insurance, clothespin salesmen bought these things back in the day, because it's fantastic. And they're not the most common things to find nowadays. I just got lucky and found a dude who had a bunch of them on eBay. But if you can find one, I'd say it's, worth a shot if you like old portables like this. Otherwise, for actually doing much with it, it's kind of not worth it. Just get any other clone PC with an actual monitor and keyboard. Yeah, because it's not for playing games. It's for curiosity. So, yeah. Well, that's it for the Zenith Z-171. Thanks for watching. Hope you learned something. If not, whatever, man. Open up your brain harder next time.